Here praising the Lord this morning, lifting his name on high. The first song we're going to sing is Forever, praising God that he is forever faithful, that he is forever with us. Let's sing to him this morning. Let's stand. Here we go. Give thanks to the Lord.
Give thanks to the Lord.
Seated. Good morning, church family. Hope everyone is great. On my way to church here this morning, I was thinking that Bible verse coming over the hill. I was glad when they said, let's go to the house of the Lord. I trust that you're here this morning. Your heart is ready to worship the words of the songs and the message that we're here this morning. Just really grateful that you're in the house here this morning. If you're here and you're new to Camano Chapel, we want to welcome you. If you have questions, if you're new to Camano Chapel this morning and you might not know the layout of the campus or a question about Sunday school class, just ask a person sitting around you, hey, tell me a little bit about your church. Everyone knows all the answers to all our church questions, right? You know where everything's at, so help people out that might be new here this morning. A couple of announcements for us. The Women of Purpose. Women of Purpose is one of the 28 ministries of our church. It's a missions organization that based from World Concern out of Seattle. has a ministry in Southeast Asia. They are having a fundraiser event this upcoming Saturday night in the upper room. Tickets are available out there in the foyer. World Concern sponsors an organization called One Village Transformed, as I mentioned, in Southeast Asia, and also deals with Seek Out and Stop Human Trafficking. Wonderful, wonderful organization. Tickets available today for next Saturday night's event, October 26th. And I promised Josie I would make a big plug for Christmas Choir. It's always a fun, fun time. The first rehearsal is coming up here on the 28th of October. So if you love to sing, this is a great place for you to use your voice for King Jesus coming up for Christmas season. And in October, we always have a big outreach here through Camano Chapel to the children in our community. Our harvest party this year is no exception. On the 29th of October, we're going to have a harvest party. I think it was around 400 children that were in this building last October for this event. It's always a great, great outreach. And we're asking if our church family would bring candy for that event. So if you have some today, there's tables in the back, you can drop that off. Maybe next Sunday you would bring some. That's a great big help for that harvest party outreach. And then finally, we wanted to do a big shout out. Pastor Matt and his junior high ministry, I think the last two or three Sundays, has been asking us to bring socks for the Everett Men's Gospel Mission down there in Everett. And I'm so happy to tell you that we as a church family brought in 1,239 pairs of socks. Yeah. When he went down with his truckload of socks to the Everett Gospel Mission, they were just blown away because they really need socks this time of the year for especially the men of the Everett area. There were so many socks that the Walmart was calling Camano Chapel because they ran out of socks at Walmart seeing if we could sell them some. So thank you. If you brought socks, thank you so much, guys. Hey, would you pray with me? We'll just continue our service this morning. Father, thank you for the song that we just sang, that forever you are faithful. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we can build our lives on the trustworthiness of your word, of your son. And we as your kids, we gather under this roof this morning. This is not the church. We are the church. We are the salt and the light of the world with a message the world is thirsty to hear about. That there's life in King Jesus. Thank you for each one that's come this morning, Father. Perhaps there are some that have a heaviness in their heart. They're going through a struggling time right now. We pray that they would drink deeply from your word this morning. Help us, Father, to love one another as we are on the same journey of faith. We're not who we used to be. We're not who we need to be. We're somewhere in transition, becoming more like your son every day of our life. So, Father, help us to really enjoy being here this morning, listening to you and your word. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, would you stand to your feet, turn yourself around, find somebody to say good morning. Good morning and welcome to church.
Together, let's sing another song to his name.
Your love is devoted like a ring of solid gold, like a vow that is tested, like a covenant of old. Your love is enduring through the winter rain, beyond the horizon. Mercy for today,
Father, that is the prayer of our heart, that we would constantly be in a state of worshiping you, whether it's when we're singing, whether we're with the people in our church, or just in our own closet at home. Whatever we're doing, God, I pray that we would have an attitude of worship, and your praise would ever be on our lips. Praise you, Father. Praise you. So at this time, we're going to dismiss the kiddos over to our Sunday school program that we have for kids. It's called Kids Cove. It's amazing. My own children attend it, and I love so much that they have so much fun over there, and they learn about how much Jesus loves them. So there's a safe check-in. Parents, you can go over and bring your kiddos over there, check them in, and come on back. We're going to continue to keep worshiping the Lord and learning from his word.
What heights of love, what depths of peace, when
God, thank you that we have a solid rock to stand on in a time when everything is changing, everything is shifting. We have this solid rock that is Christ. In and through him, we can have security. We can have hope. We have a destiny. Lord, thank you for giving us a clear call and a clear direction for our lives. It's all there in your scriptures, in your holy word. Father God, in these next few minutes, we are going to turn our hearts towards a study of your word, not only to learn intellectually, but to take what we have learned and to be different people in this new week. But Father God, I pray that you would draw our attention to you, bring forth the truth, not error, bring forth your life-transforming words. Change us. Make us new. And change our worldview, change our perspective, and change our behavior. Everything about us is changed as we trust in you and your word and the power of your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated and good morning. Open your Bibles to 2 Thessalonians, please. 2 Thessalonians. If you're new at the church, we're glad you're here, really glad. And if you're new to Camano Island, somehow you find the church, we're on the wrong side of the island here. You were driving by, you saw it, and we're glad you came in. If you are new, in your bulletin, your little program deal, there's a connection card. You can fill that out and take it out those doors to the left. They've got a gift for you if you hand it in, or if you just want to put it in the offering bucket when it comes by at the end of the service. We want to get you some more information about the church, as well as a book you'll get in the mail in the next week or two that's entitled Know Your Bible, that I think will be a real help for you understanding God's Word. Well, we are in part two now of a series entitled On Mission Together. What we're trying to do is learn who we are at Camano Chapel, wanting to communicate with you who we are and what we're trying to accomplish. Some of us, you're talking about churches that can lose their way. Some of you may have written or read the article in the Everett Herald recently. It was back in August, about these two guys that set off to go hiking, backpacking, from the Downey Creek Trailhead, which is like 20 miles east of Darrington. Anybody read that story about what happened to them? They went off, decided to kind of go off the trail, became sort of disoriented, got lost. It's kind of weird. I don't know what was going on there, but they said one of the two backpackers, he said his boot and his sleeping bag were lost in the campfire. They burned up in the campfire. And I'm thinking, man, what were they doing up there? Here's my theory, that they weren't just enjoying the outdoors, that they were kind of enjoying, that Darrington moonshine, if you know what I mean. But something was going on up there. But anyway, they got lost, wandered around, friends and family, they didn't come back to the trailhead, way back in the Cascades. The guy with the lost boot and the burnt boot and the sleeping bag, he'd sleep at night with moss. He'd pull up moss and lay it over his body. And the other guy's name was Buster. Buster Cave was the other guy. John, any relative of yours? I hope not, man, because I think more highly of you than being Buster's brother, because Buster, he went out to, because the other guy's name was David James, the bootless David James. He couldn't hike out. So Buster went out to either get help or get him a new boot or whatever. And he got further lost. Buster did. Buster said he existed on, because he left the food with David, he existed on huckleberries and ants. And he said, actually, if you read the article, he says, actually the ants tasted like sweet tarts. He said, only you got to eat them fast or they bite you on the tongue. And I said, man, that's not good. That is not good. Eventually, they were both found, and one of them had to be airlifted to the hospital for extreme dehydration. But you know, here they are, they're lost in the woods. My point here is churches can get lost in the woods. Do you believe that? Churches can lose their way, especially churches that have a long history like Camano Chapel. We go back to, 1951. If you've ever seen the old photographs, are in the, some are in the library, one's in the office. Billy Graham right out there dedicating where Saratoga Hall, 3,000 people. He was up, he dedicated that initial sanctuary, and it's incredible pictures of all the cars parked across the roadway there. And, you know, good, a great beginning, but we've got to be sure, we've got to guard, not only for now, but for generations to come. As I've said, I want to make sure that Camano Chapel's on the right track when I'm, you know, hanging out, living at Josephine Nursing Home. I want to make sure that when I get picked up in my wheelchair and I'm brought here to Camano Chapel, that things are going to be all right. So sometimes we need to go back and say, what is our mission? What is our mission so that we don't get lost? So I think it was early spring, Pastor Brett, our executive pastor, he got us all together as elders. We started out with an all-day kind of a retreat, a one-day retreat at the Lincoln Hill High School there. We had a room there, and we got together from morning until afternoon working on refining and kind of bringing a conciseness and a better clarity to the mission statement we've had here since the late 90s. And after that 7-hour or so meeting, we've met subsequently, keep working on it until this summer. We were ready to say, we're ready to bring this to the church family. And so basically, you see it in your study notes. I think I put it in there. We really broke it down to what are we trying to do, and then how are we going to do it? So the what we do is the big umbrella. We want to glorify God, love people, and make disciples. Glorify God, love people, make disciples. And Pastor Brett, of course, preached on that last week. By the way, I got an email from someone that said, hey, aren't we supposed to, you know, the great commandment is to love God and then love people. And that's true. But here's why we use the word glorify as elders, because we talked about this quite a bit. The reason we use glorify instead of love God is there's a lot of people out there that right now saying, yeah, I love God, and they're living their own life. They're going the opposite way of who God is. And so what we really wanted to do was to really use a word that expressed what does it mean? How does it work out in our daily life to love God? Of course, Jesus said, if you love me, you will what? Keep my commandments. You will glorify God. And so our expression of love to God is to glorify him. So we really wanted to make sure that loving God is a life-changing deal. Can't say I love God, I'm just doing my own thing over here. So that's what we're trying to do. Now, how do we do it? And this is where I'm coming in. I'm going to take 4 weeks, going to break down this statement of our mission statement of how we do this to really explain how it works out in our daily lives. So how we do it is in God's strength, we equip believers with biblical teaching to become more like Jesus and reach the lost. You'll notice our old mission statement didn't say we're building, it talks about building people up, but didn't say biblical teaching. Well, we're living in such weird times now. A lot of churches, you know, they don't preach out of the Bible anymore. And so we realize, wow, we've got to clarify who we are. We are a Bible teaching church. So we're going to break this down, this part of how we do it over 4 weeks. Today I want to talk about the three words and these words that begin of how we do it here in God's strength. These three words make all the difference in the world. Or I should say all the difference in the church. Because if we seek to accomplish God's will without God's power, we're certainly going to fail, aren't we? It's not going to be a good look of moving forward. And so that's why the elders wanted to start with, how are we going to do this? Let's acknowledge that it's not by our own awesomeness, but by the power of God. So this brings us to 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 11 and 12. Just two verses we're going to we're going to kind of dig through here. In these verses, Paul is going to tell the Thessalonian believers, that's in Eastern Greece, he's going to be telling them what him, Paul, and his mission team are praying about. What's important? Why are they praying, and what are they praying because of their relationship with the Thessalonians? And what he's going to do in this prayer, it's very brief, what he explains to them they're going to pray about, he's going to talk about how, he's going to talk about God's strength and in two formats. One, God's strength and our worth. Where does our worth come from is what he's going to tell them he's praying about. That they're going to understand where their worth is coming from, and it's from God's strength. And then he's going to talk about our success as a church family, for you and I, us, and individually, God's strength, and how does it relate to our success? So, first part of verse 11, God's strength and our worth. Paul says, to this end. Now, if we look at the previous section, because to this end, he's saying, as a result of. You can see that he writes about the return of Christ. Because Christ is returning, he's going to make everything right at that time. Because of this, to this end, we always pray for you. So he's saying, man, me and Silas and Timothy, my missionary team, we're always praying for you. This is our prayer, and this is what we're concentrating on. This is a very important prayer, is what Paul is saying. We're always praying about this. What are they praying? That our God may make you worthy of his call. We're praying, we're always praying this prayer for you. Whenever we think of you, we're praying that God will make you worthy of his calling. We don't make ourselves worthy. Did you know that? Notice, make you worthy, or our worth is made by God. It's another way of saying make you worthy. Our worth, any worth that we have, is made by God. And he's saying God is going to make you worthy of his calling. Now, what is he talking about, God's calling? Well, Bible translators, not translators, interpreters, commentators, they have two views. One view is that God's calling is the initial act of getting saved. This is the view that God calls us, we trust Christ as our Savior, we're saved, and his calling is complete. He's called us to that. The second view is when the Bible talks about God's calling, it's the full comprehensive purposes of God. That it's not just that event that we would say conversion. Yeah, I got saved back in 1982. But it's the full unfolding purposes of God, the drawing us into salvation, trusting Christ. And then by the Holy Spirit, he's growing us. We're being transformed. And then when we die, our spirit goes to be with the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be at home with the Lord. But we're there, sort of a disembodied spirit. It's not like we're bummed out. I'm naked. It's not like that. But we're in joyful anticipation towards the resurrection of our bodies. And so we're watching, and the calling of God goes along for the individual from trusting Christ, or even his call before salvation, transformation, presence of God, the resurrection of the body, and you move on into eternity, you know, the new heaven and the new earth when all is complete. It's the big purposes of God. That's what I think when we talk about God's calling. I hear a lot of Christians say, you know, not a lot, but some say, I got saved. I was called by God and I got saved. Again, you know, back in 1982 or 1999 or whatever the date. And it's sort of like the call is finished. God called us on the phone. Hey, I want you saved. Okay, I'll be saved. And he hung up. To have found God or to be found by God is just the beginning. It's all Jesus from here to eternity. And the call of God is just so much more than just an event. And, oh, with all my heart, I want you to know, don't focus on the event. All right, I'm saved. I got it under control. I'm going to heaven, and I'm set. Man, there's so much more. Don't miss out on the big picture of God's calling. So as we look at the big picture of God's calling, Paul is saying here, God is going to make you worthy of not just I got saved in an event, but the whole panorama of God's plan, all of that, our worth, is made by God. We are made worthy by Him. So we're on a mission together. This is our series. We're on a mission together as a church family to respond to the worth that God has given us in Christ. We don't try to become worthy before God. He makes us worthy. Now, what we view as the source of our worth is going to impact the effectiveness of our mission as a church. Here's why. If you and I think that we've got to struggle and strive to earn God's favor, what happens is we may be doing good works, but there's an inward focus. This is about me, myself, and I. I'm trying to gain worth before God. So we turn inward and we turn selfish. But when we understand that at the cross, and when I trusted Christ, for me it was 1976, I was made worthy. I was made worthy in Christ. So now I am at rest, and my focus can turn away from inward to other people and from selfish to selfless. I'm not trying to earn some points before God. I'm simply responding to the worth He has given me in loving and trying to care for other people. Someone once wrote, I wish I knew who it was, but a great statement. He said, he or she said, the humble person doesn't think lowly of themselves. They simply don't think about themselves at all. When I understand that I am made worthy through Christ and His blood that was shed, what happens is you and I, we start thinking less about ourselves because we are at rest. We were weak and heavy laden, burdened down. Now we come into Jesus and He says, you are at rest. In fact, by the way, we are on an eternal Sabbath rest. It's fulfilled in Christ. We're resting from our own labors and now simply responding to the worth we already have. A lot of times as a Christian and in our culture, we have people that are trying to gain this worth, trying to gain self-confidence. And I read this article, the title just grabbed me. The title, this was written by a mom and it was written to parents. And the title of her article was this: Why We Shouldn't Teach Our Kids Self-Confidence. Doesn't that kind of grab you? Why we should not teach our children self-confidence. When I first read that, I thought, what does that mean? And I began to read the article, and she started to talk about the unhealthiness of trying to find confidence by our own performance. And so what I like to do, as you have in your study notes, you've seen these from time to time, my understanding of the Christian life is it starts with a change of thinking. We used to think that way, but God's ways are completely different. So what I like to do is I like to look at secular thought, and then how does that translate? What's the better thinking in Christ? So I took that article. She had several unhealthy results of self-confidence. Then I set them up against, I started to think about, well, what kind of confidence should we have then? Should we go around saying, I can't do anything, I'm just a failure? And I thought, you know what is best described in the kingdom of God is confidence in God. Not self-confidence, not in me, but confidence in God. So let's kind of walk through these in that chart in your notes. So self-confidence is determined by unreliable emotions. What I mean by that is, if life's going good for us, maybe we've had some victories, we were promoted last week, got a little bit of raise, you know, and we're feeling good about ourselves, our emotions are up, we feel confidence. But then they say to us, actually, we promoted you, but you've been on the job for a week, you're not a match, we've got to put you back to your old job. What happens? Our emotions are up and down, and we lose our self-confidence. However, confidence in God is determined not by subjective, unreliable emotions. It's determined by the objective truth of God's love. God's word says, God says to us, I have loved you with an everlasting love, which means no matter what, we're up, we're down, we got promoted, we got demoted, we got fired. God's love is steady. Isn't that a wonderful truth? Man, have you ever felt like you were worse than the dirt on the floor? You had really messed up. I have. And to return to that objective truth, God still loves me. Man, that's far better than self-confidence. Number two, self-confidence is determined by not making the allotted share of mistakes. So culture says, a lot of times we will see, you can make certain amount of mistakes, and then we're going to cut you off, and you'll never be forgiven again. Let me expand that. There seems to be certain wrongdoings that secular culture says, oh, you're out of bounds, you'll never be forgiven. Did you see where, you know, that police officer, she shot and killed someone, and she got convicted of murder? And the brother of the man who was killed asked the judge, can I give her a hug? And I read that he shared with her, you know, Jesus loves you. He was a Christian. He hugged her. And now in the media, social media, he is getting hammered. How dare he offer forgiveness to her? And there's a lot of things involved if you read that news story. It just would take too much time. It's very complex. But that sense of you're out of bounds. And there seems to be no expiration date to be forgiven. I mean, you got people that, I don't know, are running for a political office or whatever. They're like 50 years old, and everyone's saying, oh, but you did that bad thing back when you were 6 years old. Oh, come on. You know, there's this there's no expiration date of unforgiveness in secular culture. So someone can be shot down, they'll never be able to gain any kind of confidence, but confidence in God is determined by the truth that in Christ, no one at no time is irreparable. That's the story of redemption. There's always hope. I don't care how we messed up. God says, hey man, let me pick you up off the floor. We're gonna pick up the pieces of your lives. We're moving forward. That is so unlike what we would see in our, you know what those are, our tolerant culture. I find our tolerant culture quite intolerant. Certain people are claimed to be irreparable. I don't care if a guy's on death row, serial killer. If they come to know Christ, I know this is just blows our mind, comes to know Christ, man, hey, they're a new creation. God's grace reached down to them. Thief on the cross, not a good guy. Have you ever thought, oh, that thief on the cross, he was framed. He was actually a little boy in Sunday school. He got framed for something. No, he's a bad dude. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Hey, today I'll see you in paradise. Self-confidence is determined by physical appearance. We are the idol of appearance, which really bugs me because I'm bald. Since I can never be with the cool kids, you know? But here it is. Confidence in God is determined by the truth that you and I, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. Bob Taylor was a guy who came to church here for years. Some of you may know him, Brenda Taylor. Bob had got Alzheimer's. He's passed away. Brenda still goes here. Bob's a funny guy, and he one time gave me a little plaque. And you've probably heard it, but this little plaque, it's got this cute-looking guy, he's bald. Only he's got one hair. It goes up and goes like this, you know. And I'm envious whenever I see that little plaque kind of. He's got that. But anyway, he gave it to me, and it said, you know, you've heard this, God gave some people hair, and for perfect heads, he made them bald. And you know, I love that. I actually put it up in my mudroom. So I come in from the garage, put my keys in my little Tupperware thing, take my shoes off, I look up there. Oh yeah, I am a cool kid after all. You know, confidence says, hey, this is me. This is me. But I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. God made me this way. Self-confidence is determined by how blessed our life appears to be. Is anybody getting sick of seeing hashtag blessed? Basically, hashtag blessed is a way to boast about yourself. Hashtag blessed, I just got a pay increase. I'm now running the company. And I've just bought a brand new Mercedes, but hashtag blessed. You know, man, confidence in God is determined by the truth that God even lovingly allows suffering for our good. On our worst day, on our very worst day, God's working in our life. That's a great, great truth. Self-confidence is determined by embracing opinions that are trending in culture. In other words, if I want to be part of the cool kids, I may not believe that trend, but I got to say that I do. See, but confidence in God, it gives us a strong character. Confidence in God is determined by the understanding that God's word is authoritative and unchanging. I think to the person that has true confidence, confidence that we were created to have, which is confidence in God, there's a sense of a steadiness. They're not, yesterday they were over in that trend, now they're over in that trend. They're just steady as you go because of the unchanging and authoritative word of God. So our worth is in God and God alone. Well, the second part of verse 11 and 12, we'll take a few moments on this. Let's talk about God's strength and our success. So God makes us worthy. Pray that our God would make you worthy of his calling. And that God, you see the connection, second part of verse 11, and that God may fulfill every resolve for good and every work of faith by his power. I love that word fulfill. To fill to the top, that's the meaning of that word. It's like filling a glass of water. God's going to complete it. He's going to fill the resolve, every resolve or every desire for good and every work of faith by what? Not my power. Not your power, his power. In fact, there's something absent in the second part of verse 11. It's the word your, Y-O-U-R. It doesn't say that God's going to fulfill every one of your resolves for good and every works of your faith by your power. I'm kind of wondering if the whole kit and caboodle, whatever that, what is a kit and caboodle? Anybody know? Anyway, I'm wondering if the whole kit and caboodle is Jesus Christ from first to last. That it's his resolve. It's God who works in us to will and to act according to his own good pleasure. For every work of faith, I think that's God giving us the inclination. Why did that guy said, Jesus, I believe, help my unbelief? He understood it's God's work of faith and by his power. So the inclination for faith and the outworking of his faith is the ability comes from God. It's all God. So that, verse 12, because it's all Jesus, so that, here's the reason why we need to understand it's all his power, his work of faith, his resolve, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you. Not with you. It's not like, Jesus, you get a little glory and let's split it 50-50. No, in you. And you and him, only as we are united in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. God is the basic cause of anything good. All good gifts come down from God, and I would assume it's even that will, that resolve to do good is from God. You see, we're on mission together as a church family to proclaim that any good thing that we've ever done has been done by God. You know, it's been a while since we completed Saratoga Hall, debt-free and all that. I think today would be a good day as we drive out of the parking lot. We go south and we come to the exit. We just glance to the right at Saratoga Hall. And I think we remind ourselves, and you could say it out loud, say, God did that, God alone. It's not us. Not to us, oh God, not to us, but to your name be glory. 2012, especially for young people, was a real watershed year. In that year, there was this young man. That year, he turned 28 years of age. And 4 days later, his company went public on the NASDAQ stock exchange, and he became a multi-billionaire overnight. The company was a little corporation called Facebook. Mark Zuckerberg, billionaire overnight. It coined a new phrase. That event in 2012 was a culmination of 2 decades of teaching about self-confidence and success and what I can accomplish in this life as a person. It sort of culminated in this because there's a new phrase. You've heard of a midlife crisis? A Midlife crisis is when someone in their 40s or 50s just feels like, what's it all worth? I thought I would be really popular, famous now, and here I am, I'm trudging along, I just want to quit. Well, since 2012, there's a new phrase. It's called the quarter life crisis. Young people in their 20s are saying, my goodness, I thought I was going to be a world changer now. I thought I was going to be famous and wealthy, and I'm living in my mom's basement. And it goes back to 2012. You read about this. It was this moment in history where 20-somethings, and it's not just 20-somethings began to have a quarter-life crisis. It's us that are of all generations saying, wow, Mark Zuckerberg did it. Why couldn't I do it when I was in my 20s? Quarter-life crisis. That event in 2012 was combined with two false concepts that have been just so popularized in the last two decades. The first false concept is this. We've been taught, many of us since we were very young, if you work hard enough, you can be anything you want to be. False concept number two. You can be the best in the world. See, the truth is this. We talk about God's strength and our success. Truth is this. You can accomplish what God wants you to accomplish and only by his power to accomplish it. Amen. It's all Jesus from first to last. And oh, by the way, what does God want to accomplish in you and I? It's a little thing called character. He wants to change us. I'm a village missionary, so it's a mission to rural United States and Canada. And Camano Chapel is maybe a little different than a lot. Well, it is different. A lot of these churches are in really out-of-the-way places. In fact, I think I shared with you the one village missions church that has a claim to fame is they are 30 miles from pavement. You have to drive 30 miles down a gravel road to get to that little white church out in the Montana pastures out there. Cows come up and look in. Some cows get saved, I've heard, but I don't know. I haven't been there. But anyway, so once a month, it's kind of a tradition in village missions all across the United States and Canada. Some people drive for hours. They come, and a lot of these couples, these village missionaries, husband and wife, they're lonely, and they get together once a month. So we have a little gathering here, trying to follow, you know, we're following the village missions tradition. Once a month, we gather for lunch over at Smoky Point at Red Robin. Just get together and talk. There's like five or six couples there. There's one guy I really connect with, Tony Bittner. Pastor Tony. Pastor Tony comes down to the flatlands down here. He's the pastor of the Skycomish Community Church. You ever seen Skycomish? You know, it's just, you don't even pass through it. It's so insignificant, it's off to the side on your way to better places, to go to Leavenworth or go skiing up at Stevens Pass and break your leg and everything goes with all that. That's another story. So you just see it to the side, little town of 200. And right now, they're getting ready to wrap up their service. Don't think I'm wrapping up ours right now, but they're getting ready to wrap theirs up. That old little white building, 25 people have filed in today. Pastor Tony to preach the word. In fact, I was at the Heritage Service. Pastor Bill Whalen was out there. He preached up there on Easter Sunday. I said, hey, Bill, is about 20 or 25 people go to Skycomish Community Church? What'd you have on Easter Sunday? He said, maybe close to 20. I said, we'll round it up. We'll say there's 20 people there on Easter Sunday. 20 people filed in today to hear Pastor Tony. Now, a lot of people would say, wow, what a loser. Just a nobody. Here's Tony and Kathy. They've been there 7 years. They know everybody in that town of 200. That town trusted them. They had a lot of pastors, you know, people, kind of stepping stone. I can be here a year and move out. Now here's Tony, Kathy, they're there 7 years. They have a ministry of taking the elderly down to the hospital in Seattle for chemo treatments, for to visit the hospital. And while they're there, they pray for them. They talk to them about Jesus. In fact, Tony, twice a week, he goes downriver to a cabin. There, down there, there's this reclusive elderly veteran. Hasn't left his house for like years. Tony goes down there, brings his groceries, brings his medicine, prays with him, shared Christ with him, that man has come to know Jesus. Tony is dearly loved, and Kathy in that community. I asked Tony, last time we had Red Robin, I was eating my little Red Robin burger. And I think he was having a salad. I thought he looked pretty healthy to me. But I didn't want to have a salad. But anyway, I said, hey, Tony, what's your future goals? I just want to die in Skycomish serving that community. Again, some people would say, what a loser. I would say he is wildly successful. In fact, I am convinced God would say he's wildly successful. There's no doubt in my mind that when he's in the presence of God, he will hear those words we all want to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. So listen. Maybe you're looking at your life and you're saying, wow, this is it. I'm trying to love my family. Involved in church. I thought by now, hey, listen, I thought probably a decade ago, I'd be the next Chuck Swindoll. But I'm only Chris Kramer. However you're serving, whatever your place in life, you know what? You just trust God, be obedient to him. He's going to accomplish through you by his power what he's called you to do. It's in his strength. The three words will make all the difference in our lives. All right, let's stand together. I want to pray. We'll get the worship team back up here. By the way, I have a meeting, an encouragement prayer the pastors do right after the service, so I won't be able to greet you at the door. So I greet you in the name of Jesus, okay? Yeah, we're going to meet right after this. I'm going to slip out for this time. Oh, Father God, I think there's just a sense of a sigh of relief to realize I'm God's workmanship, and he's going to accomplish whatever he has chosen to do as I'm simply obedient to his call. He's going to do his work by his power, even if it's just touching one life. Hey, what's the value of one life? If we only make a difference in one life, they come to know Christ. Man, I call that priceless. So, Lord, turn our hearts away from the big glamour stuff. And just, God, get us down on our knees, washing the feet of people. As I've oftentimes said, let's not worry about being a world changer. How about let's focus on being a diaper changer in the church nursery? Let's just serve. Humble faithfulness. It's character. God, give us a new understanding of that concept in your strength. And then, Lord, for those that do not know Christ today in this room, perhaps, Father God, I pray that they, by your strength, would trust Christ as Savior, and by your strength be saved from the penalty of sin, and to be forgiven and have a relationship with you for all eternity. It is through faith in Christ alone, as we sung earlier, in Christ alone, and his sacrifice, his substitution on the cross for us. He became sin for us, that we might receive your righteousness, God, in Christ. Your worth. The worth of Jesus. So, Father, draw those to Christ who need you and need to be saved. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers,
let's sing together.
Your praise will ever be on our lips. Well, thank you so much for joining us today as we praise God and we learn from his word. If you have questions, if you need prayer, if you need someone to talk to, Pastor Mitch is going to be right up here to meet with you, to pray with you. And I hope you have a wonderful day. Thank you so much for joining us. Go with God. Happy Sunday.